ICT. I'm Dr. Pushka, director of the center. It is a rare privilege for me, for all of us, I think, to be here together, because we have with us, in this continuing series of distinguished lectures on maritime security and naval diplomacy, under the aegis of, under the framework of Goa Maritime Dialogues, two former chiefs of naval staff, Admiral Arun Prakash and Admiral Sureesh. While Admiral Prakash will speak on India's maritime security, perceptions and changing demands, Admiral Mehta's topic is maritime awareness and naval diplomacy. I'm also delighted that we have with us Professor Varun, Sahni, Vice Chancellor of Goa University, to chair the session. On behalf of ICT, I would also like to congratulate Dr. Bilhan, the organizer of these distinguished lectures, for bringing a number of formidable experts, really, on maritime issues to Goa and particularly to ICT. Since I'm an ICT man, I need to also talk about what we're going to be doing in the next month or so. In fact, today we have just confirmed that we have the Venerable Tenzin Priyadarshi, who is the founding president and CEO of the Dalai Lama Center for Ethics and Transformative Values at MIT, and by which I mean the real MIT. The founding members of the Dalai Lama Center include Jody Williams, Nobel Peace Prize winner in 1997, Mary McGuire and Betty Williams, Nobel Peace Prize co-winners in 1976, Shirin Ebadi, Nobel Peace Prize winner in 2006, Bishop Desmond Tutu, and of course His Holiness the Dalai Lama. The Venerable Priyadarshi has an undergraduate degree as an integral honors scholar studying philosophy and physics, and has a graduate degree in comparative philosophy of religion from Harvard. He studied, trained, and was ordained by His Holiness the Dalai Lama. He has been interviewed by the National Public Radio, and articles on him and his work have appeared in the New York Times and the Boston Globe. Venerable Tenzin lectures internationally on subjects ranging from philosophy, science, ethics, and religion to sociopolitical thought. So this talk is going to be on the 7th of May, and I'm announcing it very early because it's a Sunday evening, around 6 o'clock. I now invite Dr. Pradhan to take charge and to welcome you all for the talk. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Pushkar, for this wonderful collaboration that we have. On behalf of our maritime project, I take this opportunity to welcome the distinguished panel here, Admiral Arun Prakash, Admiral Sules Mehta, and Professor Varun Sahni, for substantially evaluating the orientation and the directions of the American project research that we are doing it. Last two sessions particularly, we are more focused on the geopolitics and naval diplomacy, and I look forward to today's session where more naval diplomacy and security as a currency of engagement that will be more discussed by both the former chiefs of Navy staff. Today, in fact, when we look at, in my classroom also, we talk about maritime security and naval diplomacy, and youngsters also talk about South China Sea or OPOR. These are all common buzzwords in the entire this part of the world. One road, one belt, China, and everybody is apprehensive. While naval diplomacy and security is one of the concerns of the project investigation project research, in the process of looking at the whole space of maritime research, we are also talking in terms of creating or looking at the prospect of creating a maritime goodwill corp for India. Do we have space? Yes, competition is yes. But do we have the scope for coexisting or initiating cooperation? While context can always be negotiated, do we have the option of having good trade engagement, peace engagement in the African coast, this coast of Africa, in the Gulf of Aden, in Southeast Asia, many of these areas. In the process also, I'm talking to the naval academics in Vietnam, Indonesia, and some of the Southeast Asian countries who have equal concern of looking at the possibility of peaceful trade and economic engagement. However, security and naval diplomacy, they go along with the peace initiatives also. It is in that context I thank both the admirals for consenting to join and speak on this subject, and also thank Professor Varun Sahni for consenting to chair this session. And with that note, I now hand over the session to Professor Varun Chan Sahni, who will be chairing the entire proceedings of the next panel.
Good evening. Before we get started, it's a real honor, I must say, to be here so soon again in the Maritime Dialogue series that Dr. Pradhan has initiated, which I think is a huge academic contribution. And I think, I believe in some ways, could even end up being a very valuable policy contribution to our understanding of the seas around us and the way they impact upon our country, the way they impact upon the interests of our country. And it's particularly a matter of honor where one is chairing the panel, within quotes, chairing, of course, when the two co-panelists are former Navy chiefs. It's really, really wonderful to be here this evening with all of you. These two gentlemen who are going to be speaking to us this afternoon, they both are absolutely the best equipped people who can address issues relating to sea power, national security, naval diplomacy, maritime awareness, and the entire gamut of issues that we are going to be covering today. They're both naval aviators. In fact, I believe, along with Admiral Ram Pilani, the only three term naval aviators who ended up as Navy Chief. That's also just interesting in a way, because I think they bring together a sensibility not only then of the maritime dimension, which is of course such a critical dimension, but also in some way of aerospace, which as naval officers who operated in that dimension, bring another whole element of understanding for us. I'll be introducing them formally in just a moment, but I'd like to just literally in a couple of minutes or a little more than that, try to set the scene here and ask, well, what exactly are we thinking about? What are some of the issues that should concern us when we think about sea power, we think about maritime awareness, we think about naval diplomacy and so on? Because superficial reading of India's geostrategic reality would be to say that our two most likely adversaries in the future, Pakistan and China, share long disputed land borders with us. So it's easy sort of, on a first reading to ask whether in fact, this is not a bit of a siren's call, focusing upon the seas. There's a very important naval historian, Jeffrey Till, who has sort of, I think, quite importantly placed this issue. He said that most countries tend to be both sea and land powers, at least to some degree. I think that's a very important sort of salutary point for us. So to some extent, the question that we need to ask is, to what degree is India a sea power? If all countries are both land and sea powers, then to what degree is India a sea power? I think that becomes a very important question. So let's look at that. India has one of the longest coastlines in the world. If you include the islands, it's over 7,500 kilometers of coastline. It has an enormous exclusive economic zone, over 2 million square kilometers. India has extremely important island territories whose security must be ensured. Some of these tasks that therefore our Navy has, island territories, exclusive economic zones, these are very standard, obvious sort of naval tasks. But there is also lurking out there other notions of an expeditionary capability, notions of being able to dispatch task forces should national interests require that to be done. And so that raises then another whole sort of gamut of naval tasks that are different from the very standard tasks. Along with that, of course, are sea lanes of communication. We've talked about that last month as well when we met at the Maritime Dialogue. India is becoming increasingly a trading nation. A significant percentage of our gross domestic product now depends upon our external trade. Therefore, over time, sea lanes of communication have become a very, very obvious, slot protection has become a very obvious task for our Navy forces. We are, as we all know, an energy dependent nation, and as our economy modernizes, as the size of our economy increases, our reliance on overseas energy resources is only going to increase, at least for another generation and a half, maybe two generations. That's a long period of time. And these energy resources are mainly going to come to us. Some may come to us through pipelines, but the vast majority, the vast bulk of these resources are going to come to us by sea routes. There are questions here also about strategy that I'm sure we will be hearing about. You know, the notion of a sea control strategy versus a sea denial strategy. What exactly are the implications of these two strategies? What does that tell us in terms of sort of, preferred platforms, in terms of force structures and so on? Let's not forget that the Indian Navy has come to be seen in our neighborhood, in our littoral, as really a force for good. And this is something that we really should recognize. The Indian Navy is becoming a very important provider of public goods in the Indian Ocean region. A force for stability in that sense. Very important humanitarian role during, for example, the December 2004 Asian tsunami. Indian naval vessels got to Sri Lanka, got off Indonesia well before any other sort of help arrived. The anti-piracy operations, the Somali coast is another example of, a provision of what can be seen in some of these global public goods. There's a sense for, people like me who sort of look at these matters from an academic perspective that, in a way there's a critical shift that to some extent still hasn't taken place in our country. Which is to begin to see sea power, not as being power at sea, but as power from the sea. So true sea power is when you can harness the sea to enhance the powers of state and thereby of society. So that shift, when we begin to stop seeing sea power purely in terms of power at sea, which is basically naval power, to power from the sea, which is much more broad spectrum. It's about a whole range of other resources as well. And really, in some ways, therefore, we need to sort of ask ourselves, have we today the sort of Navy, but more importantly, all of the other auxiliary elements that go into authentic sea power? Not just the Coast Guard, but a merchant marine, not just the merchant marine, but a fishing industry, a shipbuilding industry, naval architecture, all of those together. This is something that we need to think about. Let's also not forget that one of our adversaries, China, is a state that is building its own sea power narrative these days. So, there's a question really about these two large continental-sized Asian countries, both sort of turning towards the sea at pretty much the same time in their history. China slightly ahead of us in terms of these of the development profile. So a whole many of resources are issues here that I'm sure that we will sort of learn a lot about this afternoon. Let me briefly be so presumptuous as to introduce my co-panelists, because they are of course extremely well known to all of us. Admiral Arun Prakash was Navy Chief from 2004 to 2006. Admiral Sureesh Mehta took over from him in 2006. Both, as I said, are naval aviators. Admiral Arun Prakash was the first CNC of the Andaman and Nicobar Command. He was Vice Chief of Naval Staff before taking over as Chief of Naval Staff. He was Chairman of the Chiefs of Staff Committee. He is a test pilot, having graduated from the test pilot school in Bangalore. He is He has studied at the Staff College in Wellington at the U.S. Naval War College. He served with the Indian Air Force in the 71 wars?
Yep.
71. 71 war, and he was decorated with the Veer Chakra. Also had been decorated with the Vishesh Seva Medal, the Ati Vishesh Seva Medal, and the Param Vishesh Seva Medal. The other distinguished speaker of this afternoon, Admiral Sureesh Mehta, who has also got a career which is every bit as distinguished, obviously, Naval Chief, but before that, Flag Officer Commanding in Chief, Eastern Naval Command. He was Director General of the Coast Guard as well. He was Flag Officer of Naval Aviation in earlier postings, and also Flag Officer Commanding the Western Fleet. After having served in the Navy, Chairman Chief of Staff Committee, he was also our High Commissioner to New Zealand. I think go by the order in which Dr. Prakash has laid it out. At first request, Admiral Arun Prakash to speak, and after that, thank you, sir.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Let me start by thanking the organizers of Goa Maritime Dialogues for having invited me to speak here this evening. I'd like to also applaud the launching of this worthy initiative, I think almost exactly a year ago. The organizers being Wits Pilani, represented by Dr. Prakash, the International Center Goa, Director Professor Pushkar, and the Indian Council of Social Sciences, Social Science Research, and of course the presence of the Vice Chancellor, Mr. Varun, Sahni, on the stage is a clear and welcome sign of support from Goa University as well. On a lighter note, I must compliment the director for having arranged the seating in this hall such that we can all claim to have spoken to a packed audience this evening. In the context of this initiative, Goa Maritime Dialogues, the old adage about being better late than never holds good here. But I find it quite amazing that a state like Goa should have ignored its rich maritime history and heritage in this manner for so long. Consider the fact that 500 years ago, when Alfonso the Albuquerque defeated the Sultan of Bijapur and established a settlement in Mela, Goa in 1510, Goa became the capital of Estado in India. Thereafter, Goa was made the administrative seat from which Lisbon's viceroys ruled all of Portugal's possessions in this part of the world. As you can see from this slide, on top is displayed the Portuguese Empire extending from the east coast of Africa, the Arabian Peninsula, right to Southeast Asia. In the bottom corner is Luis Vaz, the Camoish, who is the poet laureate of Portugal, and he spent considerable time in Goa. I think his epic poem, the Lusiadas, is preserved somewhere in Panjim. On the other corner is the coat of arms of Goa, bestowed by the Portuguese, and you can see all the maritime symbols there quite clearly. Now, how did the Portuguese rule, exercise control from Goa? The first Portuguese sailor set foot in Calicut in 1498. The period from then to withdrawal of the British in 1947 is termed by historians as the Vasco da Gama epoch, an age of maritime power exercised by this small Iberian nation, the other one of course being Spain, whose authority based on control of the seas enabled governance of its Asian and African possessions by Goa-based viceroys. So against this historical backdrop, it is indeed disappointing that the coastal state of Goa, which relies so heavily on the sea and which has such a fine maritime tradition, should have remained so indifferent to the maritime domain, and that's all the more reason that I welcome this initiative. Now sadly, this ignorance or obliviousness of our maritime past and our intimate linkage with the seas is not confined only to Goa. It extends to the rest of our country, and in the Navy we've been calling it sea blindness for want of a better term. It is endemic. So before embarking on my talk, I intend to digress for a few minutes into history, because it has a direct bearing on maritime security, which is the topic of my talk this evening. Recent developments like the promulgation of an Indian maritime strategy and a naval building program which includes aircraft carriers, nuclear submarines and so on, have intrigued foreign academic circles. In commentaries on India's naval expansion plans, American scholars, for instance, have raised two issues. Firstly, they say India lacks a grand historical narrative to lend substance to an assertive maritime naval strategy. Secondly, they wonder how India, a poor country, can justify a costly naval build-up to its own landward-looking population in the absence of what they call a usable maritime past. Now, we don't need to go around explaining our actions to foreigners, but there is a kernel of truth in what they say. Our academic community, whose eminent representatives are here this evening, have indeed not made any serious effort to establish a grand historical narrative of India's maritime past, which will justify its naval expansion plans, even to our own citizens. How do we tell our own people why we are spending hundreds of crores of rupees on building a navy? The Navy's leadership has fortunately stepped in at this juncture, and we took it upon ourselves to initiate a maritime renaissance. While laying the foundation of a strong Navy, the Navy has taken care to provide an intellectual underpinning in the form of a formal doctrine and a formal written strategy. Both are public documents available on the internet, which provide a rationale of why we are spending so much money on it. Going a step further, the Navy has also tried to revive India's ancient maritime seafaring tradition amongst the people and the youth, and the witness to that is our two young men, Captain Donde and Commander Abhilash Tomi, who navigated the globe solo, all alone by himself. And not many Indians are aware of this fact. I mean, more people have heard of Tendulkar and Gavaskar and so on than of these gentlemen who achieved far, far more in terms of achievements. So that in a nutshell is the Navy's contribution. Now, the past is never easy to reconstruct, and Indian historians have frankly, those whom I've spoken to, frankly confessed to a lack of means as well as the expertise to piece together a cohesive narrative of our past. The lone Indian voice in this historiographic void has been that of visionary historian diplomat Sardar K.M. Panikkar, of whom you may have heard. He states the claim that India's ancient maritime tradition predates the Greek, the Roman and the Carthaginian exploits in the Mediterranean, but not enough is known about it simply because of a lack of historic records. In a monograph which he wrote in 1945, no longer published, he argues that it was the Indian Ocean and not the Mediterranean or the Aegean Seas which saw the world's first oceanic sailing activity. Panikkar bolsters his claims about the shipbuilding, the ocean sailing and navigational skills of ancient Indians by extensive arguments in that monograph. He says, "It may seem strange, but it is true that till the last decade of the 15th century, none of the Europeans, except perhaps the Vikings, had ventured into ocean navigation. Only the Hindus, the Chinese, and the Arabs had developed a tradition of ocean navigation, and of these, the Hindus had the largest share till the 13th century." By Hindus, of course, he means Indians. The Chinese, on the other hand, ladies and gentlemen, seem to have found an easy and convenient way of rewriting maritime history to suit their needs. A decade ago, they commissioned a retired Royal Navy officer called Kevin Menzies to write about the voyages of the Ming Dynasty's eunuch admiral Zheng He. Of doubtful scholarly credentials, Menzies was provided generous funding and a large team of Chinese researchers, and he produced a voluminous book called 1421, The Year China Discovered the World. This book came out about 10 years ago. It became a bestseller overnight, sold thousands of copies. I would recommend it as reading to those of you who have the inclination. This book claimed that an armada of Chinese junks led by Zheng He sailed in March 1421 on a voyage in which they allegedly discovered Africa, South America, Antarctica, Australia, New Zealand, Greenland, and even North America. So according to this very fertile imagination of this gentleman, all that was discovered, was which we assume to have been discovered by Bartholomew Dias, by Vasco da Gama, Magellan, Columbus, Captain Cook, was actually discovered by the Chinese. Why am I telling you this? Because today the narrative of Zheng He's seven voyages shapes China's maritime orientation and grand strategy, and provides the rationale for the formidable build-up that China is undertaking. In Beijing's clever narrative, the recent ascent of China's navy is portrayed as merely the latest phase in a continuum which started in the Ming era. So this is nothing new, nothing to get excited about. It's an old Chinese tradition, we're just keeping up. Presenting it as a benign development, China hopes to allay suspicions and preempt any bandwagoning or ganging up of Asian or Southeast Asian countries against this. At home, Chinese leaders invoke Zheng He to turn their own people's attention to the seas. Now, this longish prelude was to put to you that if China could creatively embellish and utilize Zheng He's voyages, which lasted just 28 years, because when he came back, the Chinese, the Ming Emperor Yongle, for some reason decided to burn all his ship, destroy all his records, and put an end to all Chinese getting about the seas. That was the end of China's ventures at sea. Now, on the other hand, we have the exploits of the Pandyas, the Cholas, the Zamorins, the Marakars, and the Maratha admirals spanning centuries. And there's no reason why we should not use these narratives to undergird the growth of our maritime power, which is criticized by others. But till Indian scholars and historians can muster the resolve to research our past and compile an authentic maritime history, this lacuna will continue to engender sea blindness amongst the bureaucrats, politicians, diplomats, and all that, for whom the sea is a big mystery. And I am glad that the Vice Chancellor is here to listen to this. So, with this lengthy prelude, I will switch tracks and come to the topic of the day, which is maritime security. Now, ladies and gentlemen, it may surprise most of you to know that the term maritime security is not as self-explanatory as it may seem. In the past, maritime nations sought what they called good order at sea. And good order was said to prevail if safety and security of shipping was assured and countries could pursue their maritime interests in accordance with international laws. Good order has now been replaced by the term maritime security, which has a slightly broader connotation and implies safety from all forms of sea-based threats. But I'm afraid the matter doesn't end here, it's not so simple, because some navies like the US and British are employing the term maritime security operations in a more restricted sense. They have drawn a distinction between the war fighting and the maritime security roles and envisage the latter, that is maritime security, as dealing only with non-military threats such as piracy, people, drug and arms smuggling, terrorism, proliferation of WMDs and fisheries protection. There's a fine distinction. Now, India's maritime security strategy, which is a document that I've just mentioned, on the other hand, describes the aim of maritime security as safeguarding national maritime interests at all times. Under this umbrella aim, it goes on to spell out the following five maritime security objectives. One, to deter conflict and coercion, to conduct maritime military operations, to shape a favorable maritime environment, to protect India's coastal and offshore assets, and to develop requisite forces. Our maritime security strategy is, in fact, a combination of five constituent strategies which correspond to each of these objectives which I've displayed on the screen. And the Navy offers a dual rationale for this different approach. It says, firstly, that the growth in the variety of threats, non-military threat, that is, the blurring of line between military and non-military threats, requires a holistic approach towards maritime security. And secondly, post-26/11, the Bombay terror attacks, the expanded mandate, which includes coastal and offshore security, calls for integration between the functions of the Navy and the Coast Guard. So that's the reason that the Indian Navy has decided to take a slightly different approach. This approach is at variance with the approach adopted by other navies, which I just told you. They, as I mentioned, have split maritime security into two components. One is the home component, which relates to law enforcement, etc., which is given to the Coast Guard, and the other is the away component, which deals with matters of national security. But having said that, there is an overlap between the Navy and the Coast Guard, and that's something that we have to live with. Now, I'm not going to dwell on this, on these topics of maritime strategy, given the nature of the diverse audience here. So I will provide you a general overview of the current security issues, some of which were mentioned by Mr. Varun Sahni, India's maritime interests, the nature of threats we face, and the options available. I hark back to Panikkar, because in 1948 he had pointed out to our sea-blind countrymen the vital significance of the Indian Ocean, not just for our prosperity, but for the very existence of India as a free nation. He had clearly enunciated that our interests in the Indian Ocean were different from those of other countries. These are his words. He said, to other countries are not as dependent on, as India on this ocean, on which her vast trade has found its way to the marts of the world throughout this world. However, his conclusion that the Indian Ocean must therefore remain truly Indian was somewhat chauvinistic and not quite practical. While India has consciously refrained from appearing over-possessive of the Indian Ocean, it has not always succeeded in dispelling this impression. At the same time, India has diligently tried to achieve geopolitical unity of the Indian Ocean region by fostering cooperation through multilateral forums, and good examples are the Indian Ocean Rim Association, or IORA, and the Indian Ocean Naval Symposium, whose founder is sitting right here on my left. While Indian Ocean endeavours have for various reasons produced limited results, India's other initiative, a Look East policy to cultivate economic links with the Pacific Ocean neighbourhood, has met with considerably more success, especially after it was given a more proactive slant and renamed the Act East policy. Many felt that the time had come for India to cast aside this dual orientation, Indian Ocean on one side, Pacific on the other, and approach a more holistic approach, but a slight terminological impediment existed. And this relates to the term Asia-Pacific, which is coined post-World War, presumably by the US State Department, in order to create economic and military linkages between USA and nations of the Pacific. Focusing mainly on Northeast and Southeast Asia as well as Oceania, it tended to exclude countries west of Malacca Strait, countries like India, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka. However, with the rise of India and China on either side of Malacca Straits around 2012, a new term, the Indo-Pacific, began to replace Asia-Pacific in strategic history. The 2015 US Maritime Strategy went a step further and threw up yet another phrase, the Indo-Asia-Pacific. This is said to span and expand from the west coast of the US to the east coast of Africa. Now, it's interesting to know that even as Indian diplomats shy away from these new terms, Indo-Pacific and Indo-Asia-Pacific, they also deny the existence of an Indian Monroe Doctrine. New Delhi does consider itself the leading Indian Ocean state and a natural leader of this region. Its proprietary attitude perceives the presence of extra-regional powers, particularly China, as undesirable and even provocative. China, on the other hand, refuses to recognize India's claims towards great power status or any special prerogatives in the Indian Ocean or even within South Asia. Beijing also views the Indo-Pacific formula as a convenient hyphenation between the two oceans because it suits the US state enforcement. So we are not very clear which term suits whom and which one we should adopt and reject. In my personal opinion, the Indo-Pacific formulation is certainly in consonance with India's Look and Act East policies and will help ensure that India is no longer excluded from economic and security initiatives in that region. Indo-Pacific also provides a handy umbrella under which we can create new partnerships across Malacca Strait as we are trying with Vietnam, with Australia, with Japan, and so on. Let us now cast a quick look at India's maritime interests. And nothing new that I'm going to tell you, but just a reminder, most of them were mentioned by Professor Sahni. Geopolitical realities of South Asia have rendered India as dependent on seaborne trade and energy traffic as any island nations. As you're aware, our northern and eastern and western borders are all more or less blocked. India has a respectable merchant fleet comprising 1,200 ships of over a million tons, of over 10 million tons, and this places India amongst the ranks of leading seafaring nations. India's exclusive economic zone of 2.5 million square kilometers supplies about a third of our hydrocarbon requirements, but there's a huge wealth of minerals and resources in the seabed. And collectively now it's being called the blue economy, which whose contours have not really been explored, but there's a lot of potential. The waters of the Indian Ocean see over 100,000 merchantmen in transit annually, carrying a cargo of worth $1 trillion. Both eastbound and westbound traffic is vulnerable to various risks and threats. India's long peninsular coastline, studded with many ports, gives it a strategic location astride major shipping lines. It also has island territories on both seaports that provide useful maritime outposts. The Negative Group on our west lies across the Arabian Sea shipping line, and the Andaman and Nicobar Islands is very well situated to keep an eye on the Malacca Strait, and it has often been referred to as the Malacca chain, chain around Malacca's neck. Less well known are India's steadily growing interest in the Pacific. Almost 55% of India's trade with the greater Asia Pacific area transits through the South China Sea, giving India a strong stake in the freedom and stability of sea lanes there. The Indian oil major ONGC Videsh, apart from other parts of the world, holds substantial stakes in Russia's Sakhalin 1 and Vankor oil fields projects located in the Sea of Okhotsk and Eastern Siberia respectively. The same company, ONGC Videsh, has been awarded offshore oil exploration rights in Vietnam. So, today India's trading links, investment and diaspora span an arc extending from Siberia and New Zealand to its east, to Africa and Central Asia to its west. It also goes beyond to Latin America, but I am not mentioning that. Any attempts to dominate waters of the Indo-Pacific would represent a grave threat to our vital interests. While we may lack the deep pockets and dynamism that underpins Chinese overseas initiative, the Indian Navy has in a modest way concluded formal agreements whereby its warships, submarines and aircraft can put it to 25, 30 or even more ports right across the Indian Indo-Pacific for various reasons. Let me now briefly touch upon the security threats in the Indo-Pacific. In his hegemonic stability theory, political scientist George Wodelsky had posited, since the international system is more likely to remain stable when a single nation state is the dominant power, international system seeks a hegemon. Hegemonic dominance is said to occur in a series of long cycles lasting about 100 to 120 years. Now, Wodelsky based this on historical facts, starting with Portugal and Britain and other countries which had been hegemons for a period of 100 years. They rose, they fell, other countries rose and fell. So according to him, this was a cyclic phenomenon, and it is underpinned by naval power and economic dominance. According to Podelsky, the era of US dominance commenced its decline in the 1970s. So if the US is going to decline, then some other hegemon is likely to rise. That's the theory. Whether it happens or not, we have to see. Against the background of this cautionary advice, we already have enough evidence that an ascendant China, revisionist in its attitude, is bound to challenge the existing world order. The manifestation of its belligerence is a campaign of cartographic expansion that it has mounted through the 9-dash line in the South China Sea and repudiation of the 1944 Mahan line on the India-China border. Other examples of Chinese intransigence are the illegal creation and militarization of artificial islands, and the establishment of air defense zones in disputed waters. Sharply focused on asserting its maritime strength, China has created a navy which will protect its far-flung economic and political interests and project power wherever required. Chinese shipyards are rapidly adding to its fleet of modern destroyers, frigates, and diesel submarines. Its force of home-built nuclear submarines has been operationally deployed, and its first aircraft carrier is at sea with more on the way. Many of China's advances in the field of space, cyber warfare, ballistic missiles, aeronautical engineering and shipbuilding technology are truly impressive and almost on par with what the USA is doing. If they are not already there, they will soon get. The PLA Navy's prolonged anti-piracy deployments of Somalia have bolstered their confidence level and provided justification for acquiring overseas naval bases. China's footholds in the Indian Ocean dubbed the String of Pearls are meant to provide it a network of port facilities which could support long-range maritime operations. The Maritime Silk Road, which is a component of the One Road, One Belt mentioned by Dr. Pradhan, pursues an even more ambitious agenda by creating a huge arc of maritime and economic influence right across the Indo-Pacific, spanning the Philippines, Malaysia, and Indonesia and the Pacific, to Sri Lanka, Myanmar, Bangladesh, Maldives, Pakistan, and Djibouti in our part of the world. It would provide an ideal underpinning for China's maritime grand strategy, whatever it may be. Looking landwards, in our own context, the Sino-Indian military equation in the Himalayas contains very disturbing portents. Heavy PLA deployments on the Tibetan plateau, including garrisons, airfield, missile sites, linked by road and rail networks, will ensure the dice is heavily loaded against India's land and air forces. Pakistan, enlisted by China as a cat's paw, constitutes an integral part of the latter's foreign and security policy. With growing commonality of weaponry between the PLA and the three Pak armed forces, the Army, Pakistan Army, Navy, Air Force are almost totally armed by the Chinese, which has two advantages. One is that it strengthens Pakistan. It also makes it easy for China to call upon Pakistan whenever required, since the equipment is common. The deployment of PLA Navy submarines in the Indian Ocean that commenced in 2013-14 was a clear indication that China seeks to not only gain strategic superiority across the Himalayas, but also to establish maritime dominance in the Indian Ocean. With the Pakistani port of Gwadar as a logistics base and perhaps even an operational hub. Under these circumstances, India needs to look seawards and leverage its maritime advantage to evolve countervailing strategies. In this context, Indian Peninsula jutting 1,000 kilometers into the sea enables it to dominate the Indian Ocean sea lanes. At the same time, India's Bay of Bengal Islands constitute, as I mentioned, a metal chain to lock shut the western entrance of Malacca Strait. The Navy has traditionally had to struggle for an equitable share of the defense pie, but despite fiscal constraints, good planning and pursuit of indigenous shipbuilding capability has placed the iron amongst the top ranks of modern maritime forces. A quick order, a quick glance at its order of battle, as well as its order book, is reassuring. The current Navy strength of 135 ships includes an aircraft carrier and 15 submarines, of which two are nuclear powered. The Navy also operates 250 aircraft and helicopters in the fighter, reconnaissance, anti-ship, and anti-submarine roles. Naval planners envisage an enhanced force level of over 200 warships and 450 aircraft within a decade or so. Important new acquisitions will include a new aircraft carrier currently under construction in Cochin, another one on the drawing board. On order are 7 stealth frigates, 35 other warships, 6 diesel submarines, 57 fighters, 200 helicopters, and so on and so forth. A program for serial production of nuclear-powered submarines is also underway. Our 2015 maritime strategy has been crafted to take full advantage of India's favorable physical location and the Navy's three-dimensional capabilities to exercise sea control and sea denial as required, to wage raid warfare and project force in areas of interest, all the items which were ticked off by Professor Sahni. There are, however, two major fault lines that run right across India's security edifice, but rarely find mention, and I will mention them in this office. Firstly, India has become an economic and military power and a nuclear weapon state before attaining technological maturity. Today, our lethargic DRDO and defense production complex represent an Achilles heel that would constitute a major handicap in war. The armed forces remain actively dependent on external sources for weapon systems as well as many items of arms and ammunition. Even if the Make in India campaign actually takes off, it will take time to show results. Secondly, uniquely amongst major military powers, India has chosen to retain an archaic organization for higher defense management. And such is the lack of cohesion and integration between the MOD and the military and within the three armed forces that it is bound to seriously impair our war waging if. As I approach the end of my talk, I need to draw attention to yet one more important lacuna in our maritime context. Again, this is one that is often glossed over in government rhetoric. Now, lay persons such as those in this audience may be surprised to learn that maritime power encompasses much more than a fighting navy about which I am going to talk. And while the process of building a navy has received adequate attention, the other constituents have unfortunately suffered severely. And I'll mention them. Our ports and infrastructure are outdated and inefficient. Our shipping fleet has been stagnant for years. We haven't added much tonnage. Our shipbuilding industry is sluggish and inefficient, and we lack a deep sea fishing fleet as well as the technological ability to exploit maritime resources. And above all, we have not cared to train manpower for all these functions. India's hopeless failure to focus on maritime capacity building represents not just a huge economic missed opportunity, but also undermines our maritime power. By way of contrast, ladies and gentlemen, China is already a world leader in shipbuilding. As the world's largest merchant fleet as well as fishing fleet, its Coast Guard is already the largest in the world, and in a few years, the PLA Navy will be the world's second most powerful navy. And yet, China's leadership has not yet claimed that they are a maritime power. We, on the other hand, have offered to become a provider of net security in the Asia-Pacific. There are a couple of rays of hope in this arena, and they are represented by Prime Minister Modi's Sagar and Sagar Mala initiative. The first, Sagar, is an acronym for security and growth for all in the region. It's a slogan for regional maritime cooperation, which was coined by him. And the second is the revival of a dormant project for port-led development in the maritime sector. However, the success of both these projects depends entirely on the zeal and energy with which the diplomats and the bureaucrats pursue them, and that, to my mind, is not a happy omen. So given this state of play, what are the choices before India? Indo-Pacific order and stability have for the past six decades been underwritten by strong US maritime presence. When the growth of China's military strength and its aggressive conduct set alarm bells ringing in this part of the world, the US pivot to Asia was organized to convey a signal of reassurance to us. However, it soon emerged that the US options for its implementation were severely constrained by many factors, including deep economic interdependence on China. On China's part, given its growing military strength and revisionist outlook, it will push its influence in the region, grab territory, and rewrite the rules of international conduct to suit itself. It has lately roiled the waters of the South and East China Seas, as well as the Indian Ocean, by its outrageous claims about core national interests, its contemptuous dismissal of the UN arbitration on sovereignty issues. Choices for India in the face of Chinese hegemony are stark. The constraints of our political system render it unlikely that India can bridge the economic and military gap vis-a-vis China within the foreseeable future. Under these circumstances, a military confrontation would be imprudent, and India needs to buy time. Amongst the more viable options for India would be to create countervailing power balancing commissions. And in this arena, we have fortunately the Indian Navy, which took the initiative 25 years ago of reaching out to its US counterpart and starting a series of exercises called the Malabar exercises, which have gone on for 25 years. And they have had their own momentum, and they have served to see a bilateral relation into US relationship, which has weathered many many ups and downs. In 2015, the Malabar exercise had expanded to include Japan, and it became a trilateral exercise. When we tried to include Australia, there was a loud scream from China, and they said this is an attempt at containment, so we backed out. But this option of creating a quadrilateral naval alignment where USA, India, Japan and Australia
is still a viable option, and possibly it's one of the counter-village strategies that we could. But what a warning, the curve containment carries the bad odor of the Cold War era, and maybe infeasible in the Chinese context, considering the fact that there are everyone, including the USA, has deep economic and trade linkages with China. Moreover, we've just witnessed countries like Cambodia, Laos, and the Philippines have capitulated to China, and they are doing its bidding. Malaysia is teetering on the brink, and this could lead to a rush of countries of this region joining the Chinese bandwagon. And therefore, we need to adopt a nuanced approach to China, combining active economic and diplomatic engagement with subtle deterrence to ensure that China remains within the bounds of the moment. This, ladies and gentlemen, brings me to the conclusion. And I would just say that India is in the unusual position of being a developing nation as well as a rising power. While its delicately poised economy requires peace and stability for growth, its rise to great power status will depend on adroit management of geopolitical challenges. It is encouraging to see our leadership reaching out to the Indo-Pacific neighborhood to create partnerships and cooperative mechanisms for mutual benefit. At this juncture, the Sino-Indian equation is definitely tilted in China's favor. But as a democracy, a nuclear weapon state, and a significant economic and military power, it is incumbent upon India to stand firm as a bulwark against attempts at regional hegemony. To attain its manifest destiny, India needs breathing space and help from friends. Till recently, we counted on the Indo-US relationship as a mutually beneficial trajectory which would assure us balance of power, but the recent election of President Trump has signaled a radical shift in many of America's long-standing policies, and the future is quite uncertain. The ultimate analysis, India's policymakers and diplomats must learn to play hardball and practice what they call real politique. As they do so, they must not overlook either the vital role of the seas in India's destiny or the use of maritime power as a diplomatic tool. In India's modern and capable Navy, they have a powerful instrument of state policy. The Indian Navy has also produced a user's handbook for maritime power in the form of a comprehensive maritime security strategy. The ball is now in the court of the national leadership to apply its collective mind and create a long overdue national strategy for India's maritime security. That completes my presentation. Thank you for that.
Thank you, sir. Now,
good evening, once again, ladies and gentlemen. Our session will be a very interesting presentation by Admiral Prakash. He's been my boss for many years, many long years. We've served together. And there's very little more that I can add to that. But I was, in any case, going to be talking a little more basic, because one of the things that has been bothering us, there are many jobs that I have done following in his footsteps. One of them was chairman of the National Maritime Foundation. And of course, within the Navy at different times, the sea blindness issue that he has raised is really what is bothering us a lot. In the sense that we are a maritime nation, the tube of ancient times that we brought up. But there is very little awareness. So that is, I think, where I am going to start from. And as I go along, I was hoping that this interaction would help your research scholars, etc., in trying to improve the things. But that not being the case, there will be a certain amount of repetition between what I say and what has been said so far. But just bear with us. Because my thoughts relating to, as I said, maritime awareness, that's the topic that was given to me, maritime awareness, or I would say maritime awareness, or the very lack of it, which is what I will talk about, and this intertwined with a certain amount of naval diplomacy, aspects which impinge on the maritime future of our country and India's development over the decades to come. So I shall try and rekindle your patriotic spirit by going through a little bit of historical facts myself, and raise before you in some very simple terms the basic facts that you must be aware of. Of course, it is ironical that this nation, with a coastline of over 7,500 kilometers, almost half as large as our land borders, and surrounded on three sides by the oceans, has been suffering from this term sea blindness, with very little awareness or prioritization of importance of what transpires on the seas beyond. Perhaps as Admiral Raja Menon puts it, you know, it is far easier to comprehend land issues by the common populace that are in the first place visible and then can be easily related to home and heart. Great maritime events happen beyond the line of sight and allow a nation and its people to go about their business unhampered. Further, navies, especially the relatively advanced ones, have been the most expensive in terms of capital and running costs and carry the largest technological content, besides requiring much longer gestation periods to build. Build and operate. My compliments therefore to the University of Goa and BITS for organizing this such discussion that encourages and stimulates strategic debate. I do believe that every facet of human development has a stake in preserving and promoting issues of national security. So, as India grows in economic and military strength, the significance of the maritime domain bound to increase. The country is fortunate to have inherited a maritime heritage that is rich and diverse, dating back to 3,500 BC. Long before the Europeans set sail upon the seven seas, the Indian Ocean was washed with maritime activity. Many samples unearthed at Mohenjo-daro, that is in 3,000 to 2,500 BC, trace their origins either from the shores of the Red Sea or the extreme south of India, and could have only been transported by the sea. It is a matter of simple and incontestable historical record that, as a civilizational entity, ancient India enjoyed active trade links with Africa, Arabia, Mesopotamia, the empires of Persia, Greece, and Rome. From the Bay of Bengal, Indian mariners set sail eastward in what may well have been our first look east policy, as early as the 1st century AD, and set up trading establishments in a number of kingdoms in Southeast Asia, including the present-day Myanmar, Thailand, Malaysia, Indonesia, Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos, and even China. This is evident even today in countries which have preserved the ancient Hindu culture, albeit with local variations. In fact, the three main religions which dominate the Southeast Asian landscape, namely Hinduism, Buddhism, and Islam, emanated eastwards from the Indian subcontinent. Then, as now, the wide-ranging nature of this seaborne trade required the assurance of a high degree of maritime security. Indeed, from antiquity up to the end of the 12th century, several Indian kingdoms, especially those in the peninsula, possessed significant seagoing navies of their own. What must be acknowledged and understood is that our early ambassadors laid the groundwork for what was to become a unique Indian approach to community building. That is, the ability of the Indian culture to synthesize and integrate with other diverse cultures, giving rise to stable, tolerant societies among people in lands far away. It was the Indian soft path approach which met with resounding success, assimilated into our society quite easily. ones who came across the land and ruled us for many centuries. On the other hand, those that came across the seas, the Dutch, the Portuguese, the French, and finally the British, thrust their culture on us and using the divide and rule policy dominated us for 300 years. Now, while they left behind some good laws and governance practices, they also ensured that the Industrial Revolution bypassed us completely. The loot of our raw material only went on to help factories located back home. Also, the divide and rule policy, casteism, and total servility and obeisance led to a change of character, I believe, which persists till today. And that is what we call the, you know, Jihuzur culture. Total subservience to the master and the like. I have seen this happening in Madras in the many years ago, this incident. In the Madras in Kana, we went in and the staffs are still wearing those pagadis and all those liveries. Then he comes up and says to me, "Master has come today? Master has come after a long time?" I don't know, it was probably my first or second visit to that. But that is, it is just there in the system, and I don't know how we are going to get rid of it. Nowhere else does somebody use the word sir, talking to someone, you know, every 15 seconds or 20 seconds. So there is no equality, and this is something that we need to break. That's why I try to find that. So the slide started during the, we talked about all the good parts that we were in the maritime arena. But the slide there started during the Mughal era, when the Indian ruling elites forgot the imperatives of maritime awareness, and a continental outlook had dominated the Indian mindset. The ancient and medieval India's dominance of world trade was lost. Realization that this gross neglect of issues maritime eventually led to the colonization of the subcontinent and the consequent loss of India's very independence for well nigh three centuries makes any repetition of this strategic error utterly unavoidable. These harsh lessons of history should not be lost upon the modern independent republic that is in. Since the 1990s, the Indian leadership has realized the folly of past preoccupation with our northern and northwestern borders, land borders, and now look at the seas with some renewed vigor. And thus was born our Lookies policy, part two I would call it, because I tell something else is part one. The contours of this policy were to a certain extent based on our shared collective past linkages, tempered with healthy pragmatism. And of course now, with our present Prime Minister, we have moved a step further and we now say, look east, act east. Now, the seas are a common heritage of mankind and have been used through the centuries by man for trade and livelihood. Today, the world is increasingly being integrated through hyper-globalization and the maritime dimension is gaining quantum importance because of what is called the 70-80-90 concept. Just to reiterate, what it implies is that 70% of the world's surface is covered by the oceans. Incidentally, somebody has pointed out at one time that, you know, our ancestors did not travel very far towards the land. Had they gone there, maybe the earth would have been called ocean, because it's all water, but that's an aside. So 70% of the world's surface is covered by the oceans, and 80% of the world's population is moving closer to the ocean littoral, and the majority of the world's major cities, industries, urban populations lie within 200 kilometers of the coast. And 90% of international trade by weight and volume, including most of the strategic cargo, is carried over the oceans. Also, international law provides for freedom of the seas, in which any nation can use the open ocean for purposes of trade or defense without infringement on another's sovereignty, subject of course to certain international agreements. Now, in this era of post-globalization and consequent economic development of the past three decades, we can ill afford to let our guard down. The years ahead are going to be very significant when seen in the light of our current economic indicators. Today, India is the world's fourth largest economy in terms of purchasing power parity. In fact, we fluctuate with Japan, either third or fourth. Sometimes we are third, sometimes we are Japan. In a study on India by the Carnegie Endowment entitled India, a Global Power, we are described as one of the four power centers of the world. As a demographic dividend, our vast population, which was considered a handicap only a few years ago, has emerged as a tremendous advantage with the strengths of youth, knowledge and innovation. Our geographic location, particularly in the maritime context, puts us at the center stage in today's geostrategic and geoeconomic scenarios, dominated by needs of energy security and terrorism concerns. The government's mandate to the Navy is to ensure that peace and stability prevail in the waters of our interests so that economic development can proceed uninterrupted. Please note the emphasis on economic development that is today's problem. So India's emergence as a global player has thus moved away from the realm of if and maybe. I put it to you that India has arrived. Our aspirations and quest for global prominence are inextricably linked with the oceans and will remain dependent on our ability and will use them to maximum advantage. India's rise as an economic power must necessarily coincide with a resurgence as a maritime power. Lessons from history have proved the obvious linkage between global power and maritime power. India's development in the future will be determined by how well we shape the environment to our advantage. Here, let me dive in briefly on the twin issue of energy security and the security of that energy. Both are intimately interlinked, and to a very large extent, almost completely depend upon the ocean. Our energy security is the core business of our energy ministries and their flagship enterprises. ONGC Videsh has its operations spread all over the globe, and these will only increase in the decades to come to feed our ever-increasing demand for energy. The security of our far-flank energy interests will become a strategic imperative that will depend to a large extent on our ability to provide protection from the seas. Such tasks would require our maritime forces to have extended reach and staying power. In other words, a major blue water navy to ensure security of energy and peace and prosperity for the nation. Incidentally, it is also of paramount importance that this critical cargo is carried in Indian waters, and I shall revert to this later. Conjoined with the issue of shipping and trade is trade interdependence. Trade interdependence within the Asia-Pacific region will continue to grow. As of today, nearly half of India's exports and imports are from this region. The bulk of this trade is seaborne, with the Indian Ocean being the focal point of all the major shipping routes. International shipping lanes crisscrossing the Indian Ocean carry most of the world's oil, and especially the energy requirements of the two Asian giants, China and Japan, through the Straits of Malacca, Sunda, Lombok, which in maritime parlance are referred to as choke points. Prominent maritime strategist, Holger Herwig, made a most appropriate and succinct observation in this regard when he said, Wars today do not necessarily aim at conquering territories, but rather at controlling vital littorals and choke points. Economics in general and oceanic commerce in particular are the prizes at stake. The pressure for countries to cooperate in the maritime military domain to ensure smooth flow of energy and commerce on the high seas will grow even further and will require us to focus our energies in this direction in the coming years. Whilst the India-China rivalry for influence building and resource utilization will remain a stark reality and cannot be pushed away, the challenge for India will be balance our relations in such a manner that competition for strategic resources in the strategic space in the Indian Ocean leads to cooperation rather than competition. China is firmly on track in its quest for great power, and much of it has already been said by Admiral Prakash. The Chinese long-term strategy takes into account the strategic importance of the oceans. In the Chinese vision, the oceans will play an increasingly important role in ensuring the continued prosperity of this nation, and hence must be credibly policed to protect its far-flung vital interests. Little wonder the Chinese naval transformation and the Sahni's creation of blue water assets. As our former Prime Minister Dr. Manmohan Singh would often say, that cooperation rather than confrontation should be the cornerstone of our policy. There is enough space for both of us in the Indian Ocean. Wise words, no doubt, but to put them into practice will call for depth diplomacy on both sides. Our strategic development in the decades ahead has to actually address these concerns, which, as you can see, are basically oceanic in nature. At this point, let me state quite emphatically that no nation can aspire for great power status by only buying ships. We have to build them. However, the state of our shipping and shipbuilding is somewhat worrisome. Let me present some statistics in this regard. Our shipbuilding industry is very small by present global standards. While Indian built ships constitute under 1% of the global fleet, it accounts for only 10% of the Indian-owned ships. We do not have enough Indian-owned ships to carry our energy requirements in and require additional LNG crude product carriers. The demand-supply gap between our domestic requirements and the ability of the Indian yards to deliver is becoming increasingly difficult to bridge. Faced with this situation, Indian shipping companies have placed huge orders on overseas yards, facilitating their growth and stunting our growth. The nation can ill afford this loss of opportunity to our domestic shipbuilding industry. Needless to say, measures need to be taken that will enable shipyards to increase capacity and enhance competitiveness. Productivity would need to increase and production costs reduced by a combination of improvements in infrastructure, technology, and practices. Without this, it is clear that we will have to incur significant import expenditure in sourcing ships from overseas, much against our cherished national objective of indigenization and self-reliance. The same is true for warship building. It goes without saying that with our expanding maritime responsibilities and interests, we would need to maintain our force levels and increase numbers to a certain degree. Our prospective plans have a time frame of 15 to 20 years that should provide sustained business incentives to invest in warship construction to any shipbuilder, domestic or overseas. Regrettably, however, despite a large number of warships and submarines being on order with the defense shipyards, their capacity and capability to build ships are just not enough to meet the force acquisition plans. I'm sure the Navy will be fully committed to participate in and promote any government initiative to enhance indigenous warship construction capability and capacity. However, unless a revamp of the shipbuilding industry is acknowledged and articulated as a national strategic aim, the situation is unlikely to improve in the near or medium term. The growth of shipbuilding, shipping and trade will, in turn, drive the build-up of ports, infrastructure along both our coasts, and each will continue to improve further as a result of the other as a cycling process. Closer home, in a quick look at our immediate neighborhood, we see that the Iowa littoral nations are embroiled in serious crises in the form of separatism, factionalism, ethnic cleansing, weak government control, suppression of human rights, and as a result have become easy targets for terrorists and crime syndicates to set up base. Ongoing and potential conflicts exist all along the important shipping lanes, from Bab el-Mandab and the Straits of Hormuz along the coastline to South Asia and to the Straits of Malacca, and by way of geographical extension, even to the South China Sea. So overall, it would not be wrong to describe the environment in our neighborhood in a single word, that is fragile. The major sea lines of communication for seaborne trade all converge in our vicinity as they transit through the crucial straits of Malacca, Sunda, around Sri Lanka and onward to the Persian Gulf and beyond. These straits are narrow at certain points and thus vulnerable to disruption. Many maritime threats, which include piracy, armed robbery, gun running, human trafficking and maritime terrorism, raise their ugly heads quite often. To deal with the multifarious challenges that manifest themselves in the maritime domain, countries of the world have realized that countering threats in the maritime domain calls for cooperation amongst like-minded nations. These require innovative responses. Some concepts and strategies which have been mooted and partially implemented are Regional Maritime Security Initiative, Proliferation Security Initiative, and Admiral Mike Mullen's concept of a 1,000-ship Navy. We need a consensual approach for combating such challenges, constructive engagement with the countries of the world, especially maritime nations in the areas of our interest, is undoubtedly the way forward. As a regional power and with a dominant position in the Indian Ocean region, India has taken the lead in initiating collaborative frameworks in the maritime arena. We have come a long way on issues of relevance, such as information sharing, building up interoperability with navies that operate in the region, and coordinated capacity and capability building in the Iowa Straits. There is still scope for much more. Oceanic influence on our foreign policy will grow in the times ahead. To meet the challenges of such a future, the functioning of all organs of the state, all maritime organs of the state, need to be coordinated by a single policy-making apex body. This would help to have a maritime security advisor and a maritime security advisory board. This body would synergize the functioning of more than 14 government departments and agencies responsible for various elements of maritime affairs, in addition to several security agencies with jurisdiction along the coast. This is not a new proposal, it has been in the pipeline for a long time, but that's not the same part. The maritime domain is an extremely complex environment, and the implications of our security are indeed significant. The busy sea lines of communication in the vicinity of our coasts, coupled with numerous small craft, including the largely unorganized fishing community, complicate the maritime picture. Since 100% sanitization of vast sea areas is well nigh impossible, this environment
then provides opportunities for infiltration from the sea and several other subversive activities. The first step, therefore, in safeguarding our maritime interests is to have complete domain awareness of our area of interest. Accordingly, the Indian Navy as the lead agencies has put in place a number of initiatives to enhance awareness within and around the Indian Ocean region. This includes information sharing agreements with the total nations at choke points like South Africa, Singapore, France and Sri Lanka. A high level of maritime domain awareness would be a key enabler for such collaborative maritime security framework function. Much of this work is being done by satellites which are specifically meant for this particular purpose. At the intellectual level as well, as a stepping stone towards operationalizing a maritime security framework, the Indian Navy has taken the initiative to encourage and focus on the process of constructive engagement amongst the littoral states of the Indian Ocean region, both bilaterally and with smaller neighbors, as well as multilaterally with other peers with reasonable success. A mention was also made of the Indian Ocean Naval Symposium, or IONS for short, which we started in February of 2008. Where the chiefs of all the littoral states of the IOR can periodically and regularly meet to discuss issues that bear upon regional maritime security. The objective of IONS is to establish and promote a variety of transnational maritime consultative and cooperative mechanisms designed to promote the provisions of speedy, responsive and effective humanitarian assistance and disaster relief throughout the Indian Ocean region, as also to address and mitigate other regional maritime security concerns. It also aims to encourage interoperability in terms of doctrines, strategies, organization, logistics, and operational procedures amongst the primary secure maritime security agencies of the IOR region, IOR nations. I must say that though it started with some great difficulty, I think the setup has now remained well ingrained between all the nations over here, and they are meeting every year or every alternate year in different places, hosted by different names. I will now touch upon certain aspects of this thing, bread and butter issues regarding the use of the seas in ensuring security during conventional conflict. The oceans may well be the key swing factor in any future land-oriented campaign. The oceans are a versatile medium which allows us freedom to maneuver in ways no land or air forces can afford. Unlike the land and air forces, the gradation of intent and threat can then subtly be applied to the sea. It is limited only by human imagination. It is no secret that the maneuvers carried out by the Indian Navy during the Kargil Ops did, in a large measure, make our adversary blink. It is a fact that most human maritime activities are confined to within 100 nautical miles of the coastal zones. This means that a very large proportion of the world's economic, industrial, and political activities carried out in this swath of land and sea, extending about 300 nautical miles. This is what is often referred to as the littoral, and this is where the navies of the major maritime powers are focusing. It is noteworthy that in all of the recent major conflicts, Kosovo, Afghanistan, Iraq, the major intervention by the coalition forces has not been over land, but from the littoral. The predominance of oceanic capabilities, without doubt, holds the key to success in operations in the littoral. These oceanic capabilities translate into capability to conduct maritime maneuver from the sea, out of area capabilities, and all elements of classic sea control and sea denial. Our force development aims to create all the desired capabilities by putting into execution a time-bound capability perspective plan. The current one of which is covering the period 2012 to 2027, next 15 years. Besides conflict situations, challenges also emanate from environmental disasters, oil spills, tsunamis and cyclones, all of which leave in their wake a trail of death, destruction and devastation. Humanitarian assistance and disaster relief operations will form part of the essential repertoire for navies the world over. The diplomatic dividend of humanitarian aid is simply invaluable. The Indian Navy's prompt responses in the aftermath of the 2004 tsunami under the tutelage of Admiral Arun Prakash, I was the Deputy Chief at that time, the promptness and evacuation operations that took place in Lebanon 2006 helped raise India's international stature and earned us immense goodwill. Increasing our footprint in benign operations by becoming a front runner in capacity building for such operations and developing our capability for rapid response should therefore be necessary. Another facet that will gradually attract greater attention in the times ahead is the tapping of oceanic resources. Fast depleting resources on land, the world is looking towards the seas and the space for harnessing future requirements. While resource hunting in space may still be some distance away, the seas provide a wealth of resources waiting to be tapped. Evidently, this would be a function of technology. And in the years ahead, technologies will need to be developed for ocean-based resource retrieval and utilization. Very few countries have been recognized as having this capability, and India is one of them. Our deep-sea bed real estate lies approximately 1,100 nautical miles, that is 2,200 kilometers, south of Kanyakumari, indeed a long way off. We also have our interest in Antarctica for scientific exploration as well as research. And in the years to come, there is every possibility that ocean-based resources that were once thought of as impossible to access may become commercially viable to exploit. So the next big gold rush may well be in the oceans. And for that, we must be prepared. Prepared in terms of technologies and wherewithal to exploit them, and prepared in terms of capabilities to protect them. Thus, history has come a full circle. From the days of ancient Indian mariners and the great seafaring traditions, we now again look at the oceans to fulfill our destiny as a great nation. And finally, I come to the most enduring feature of international relations, that there are no permanent friends or enemies, only interests to protect. These interests too may rise or fall in priority depending on various drivers of politics and economics. This results in an environment of uncertainty and unpredictability, which requires us to possess the requisite flexibility to deal with different situations across the spectrum of conflict. Maritime forces, therefore, cannot be built around threats from a specific nation or a group of nations. Indeed, they need to be structured to protect our own national maritime interests as far as one can crystal gaze into the foreseeable future. It is for this reason that naval plans follow a capabilities-dominant, mission-based approach. This implies that we plan to put into place capabilities to help us cope with the entire spectrum of operations, from low-intensity maritime operations right up to the nuclear threshold. In this manner, we hope that our capabilities will be flexible enough to address the uncertain conditions that will prevail in the maritime. So to conclude, ladies and gentlemen, the oceans and their exploitation will significantly impact almost every facet of natural life. Trade, energy, exploitation of marine resources for livelihood, as well as economic benefits, maritime diplomacy, access to far-flung areas of the globe for humanitarian efforts, development of shipping, shipbuilding and ports, as well as coastal infrastructure, and indeed maritime security in its varied dimensions. Planning strategies, human resource development and technologies will need to be focused on leveraging the maximum advantage from the oceans. At the cost of repetition, I would like to say that great powers through the ages have also been great maritime powers as well. Therefore, in the next decade or so, oceanic influence will significantly shape our strategic development as a great power. The challenges that the oceans bring forth and opportunities that they offer can be ignored only to our national. Thank you very much for your patience. Jay.
Thank you very much, sir. We've been privileged to have heard and witness two wonderful presentations. I'll open the occasion, the event to the audience as well. I'll just request members of the audience, while they address their questions, maybe the occasional comment.
Yeah. My name is Vivek Adyantaya. My question is to Admiral Arun Prakash. You mentioned rightly that the DRDO has been rather lethargic. I agree with you. Now, my question is there a chance for the private sector to provide help in the shipbuilding activities? I don't know whether it is practical or whether it is in the national interest, but this is just a question I want your help.
I think your question is really not, I mean, the DRDO is not connected to shipbuilding. So let's take it in two separate components. DRDO's functioning has left much to be desired, because we had great hopes from our scientists and they did show promise to start with. But over the past 70 years, their priorities have somehow turned out to be quite different from those of the armed forces. So that's where we are today. That we are largely dependent on imports as far as systems and weapons are concerned, whereas the DRDO is proceeding on its own path. So that's one aspect. The other aspect is shipbuilding. Yes, shipbuilding has so far been the warship building has been the monopoly of public sector of the public sector, and there is no doubt that they've done a good job so far, but their efficiency and their productivity would have been enhanced much more had they used the talents of the private sector shipyards. Unfortunately, there also the government has not been forthcoming. They have not encouraged, as I mentioned in my talk, we should have laid the foundation of a sound shipbuilding industry. It would have created jobs, it would have created ancillary industries, it would have strengthened our industrial base considerably. But the government has been totally negligent in ignoring the shipbuilding industry. So today we are in a situation where we have a reasonably efficient warship building industry. Its order books are chock-a-block. Any government shipyard is full of. On the other hand, private sector shipyards are lying idle. They are not being given orders. Their capacities are limited. Their skills and expertise is also limited. So there's a total mismatch, and that is why I have recommended that there should be a national strategy for maritime and for the maritime domain, so that we can synergize whatever we've got. At this moment, there's no synergy. We are under-exploiting. The maritime domain had the potential to add immensely to the national economy. So by neglecting it, we've done great harm to ourselves. And other countries like China, of course, is the prime example, but even smaller countries like Vietnam and Singapore and all their shipbuilding industries are far ahead.
The construction should happen. It should be on a certain time frame. That never happens. For whatever reason, at the time of taking the contract, there is all great enthusiasm and much fanfare. And yes, so we've got the contract for this, etc., etc. And it lags and lags, and then as it has also happened, I think, in our other construction outset buildings and all, you know, सीमेंट का पूरा प्राइस बढ़ गया तो और पैसा दीजिए व्हाई योर डाउनफॉल ऑफ दिस रोड फ्रॉम हियर टू कला एकेडमी टू हम इयर्स 5 इयर्स तो नहीं मोर देन दैट होल स्ट्रेच फ्रॉम हियर टू देयर सो एंड द पॉइंट इज द सेम द कॉन्ट्रैक्ट इज सेम आई एम नॉट बीइंग पेड इनफ यू टेक अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट एंड देन यू आर नॉट एबल टू fulfill it. So that is the attitude that is my own personal feeling or not feeling, I mean my insight into this would be that the DPSUs, let me say all PSU, not defense, all PSUs themselves had a certain place in time. Very good idea what Mr. Nehru did at that time, just after the partition time. You had no other infrastructure, therefore the government put a lot of money into those things and they delivered some goods. But in due course of time, and I think it is Professor Mahalanobis who had put through in his, as an economist, that it's time to shut down these things. When the other industry started coming up, that's not been allowed to happen. Manpower is being recruited in large numbers. You should go to any shop floor and all the filthy, lots of people, lots of breaks, green, money, chai, all that keeps on happening. And then overtime starts, costs keep going up. So therefore, we are not getting the results. Now, there have been efforts in the recent past for us to offload work to the private sector. I've been to that shipyard in Gujarat, Kambani Defense. Pipawa, when earlier it was with somebody called Mr. Gandhi, and we had given him some contacts that I was adding a postcard. So we had gone visiting over there and he had a fantastic capability. And now, more recently, I think it's even more. He has added on the largest dry dock in whole of Asia is over there. The machinery was brand new. In our case, when the DPSUs ancient, never replaced. So it is a big problem. But when it comes to contract giving, nobody in the Ministry of Defence will say that you can give a contract to a private. So I don't know. I mean, unless they can change their mindset, this will not be. Shocking things, I'll tell you, personal experience. Scorpion summary. State-of-the-art submarine we had to build over there, and it was going on. One day I went for a visit to Macron docks, and some filthy hangar that some work was going on. There's no lathe, no machinery, nothing. So I said that, you know, the floor is broken, this, that, etc. All is being built over there. So I said, how do you the press has you have to sort of make the hull. How do you do that? Yes, sir, we send the steel to some 100 kilometers away outside Mumbai, and then they, you know, he rolls the steel and gives it back to us, and then we do. So I said, why can't you have a press of, you know, 100 ton press is what you need? So yes sir. So this, the net result was, when anyway this particular thing was completed, the section, the French, who were supposed to be the designers of the thing, they came down and they said, show us the weather chart of the day that you carried out the building. What was the temperature? What was the humidity? We don't know. Nobody told us that we have to do like this. We have been building submarines for a long time. We were building the HPW submarines. We never did it there, so they're sorry, all rejected. Now the done work is rejected and we start all over again. So unfortunately the ethos of the defense PSU will not be very good. The government is fairly liberal with them and they ask for more money, that money is also given. The product never comes out on time. So that's a big problem. And I think we have, well, I did manage to push in my tenure some contracts to these, not in my tenure, but later. I was pushing myself, telling Mr. Anthony, please, let's give it to the others. These chaps have no place, no time to make. These are scholarships that we want to do. Let's give it to some grants. For
we wouldn't let, we wouldn't know this, this, that, that's the bureaucrats who brought it. After 1 year or 2 years, I met him in the corridor, you know, what you told us to do, we have done now. We're done it. One shape they ordered with somewhere else. Anyway, it's a very sordid story, but
I would rather put the entire Indian shipbuilding sector in the global perspective, that who makes the ships in the world today, if we try to understand. South Korea, around 29-30% of the ships of the world are being made by South Korea. Close to 40% are Chinese, and another 17-18% Japan. So South Korea, China and Japan, if you put them together, I think more than 80% of the world's ships are being made. Our position in that, one of my major focus in understanding the entire maritime sector is in this transport sector, that who makes the ships and do we have the ability to make it, can we participate? Our cumulative market share is 1.45% as of 2015 data I'm talking about. Additionally, if you look at it, we wanted to compare who are the top 10 shipbuilders of the world, South Korea. And if you look at Hyundai Shipping Corporation alone, they're alone, and 31 shipping corporations of India together, and very often we go in the official order of designating them as Maharatnas, Navaratnas, and Miniratnas also. We are categorized very carefully also. Hyundai Shipping Corporation's market share is 8.21% in the world. Ours, India's cumulative is 1.45%. Then we further look at the lowest order in South Korea, the shipbuilder. How does he do as far as India is compared? Theirs is also 2.21%. The lowest one, the least smallest one in South Korea is higher, much higher in terms of their productivity than the whole of India. That's where perhaps we have to seriously look at the sector as a huge possibility in that.
Department of Political Science, Goa University. We didn't expect it to be a depressing evening in that sense. Just to get back to the question of sea bandits, and this question is addressed to both of you. You mentioned that there was a general absence of importance given to the maritime issues. But would you feel that there was a kind of a general apathy towards defense thinking or strategic thinking per se, as K. Subramaniam has pointed out in his writings, and then also Jaswant Singh put it out, that there was an absence of a larger strategic thinking on part of the Indian establishment post independence, that defense is not a priority, we have other things. So could the maritime sector have become a kind of a subset in that larger context?
Dr. Tripathi, you are absolutely right that at independence, the way we got our independence through Gandhian movement, non-violence, etc., there was certainly a mindset that, in fact, Mr. Nehru said that we are a peace-loving country and it's unlikely that we have enemies and so on, and he went so far as to say we don't need an army, police will do, etc., etc. So that was the kind of mindset. But he was proved wrong very soon, that he was living in a dream world. So within that overall paradigm of sort of downgrading defense capability, maritime was very much part of it. But as I said, maritime is not just the Navy. The maritime sector is huge. We still were a seafaring nation, a maritime nation. There was nothing stopping us from building up our ports. I mean, our ports are the most third-rate and efficient ports in this part of the world. Even Colombo port is today far more efficient than any of our ports. And China has got, I think, 7 or 8 of the world's there. So there was nothing stopping us from developing ports, shipbuilding, seafaring, fishing fleet. Most of our fishing fleet of 200,000 ports is little, you know, tough about this size with one chap battling it. So given the fact that defense was downgraded in priority, and within that the Navy possibly was at a much lower, there was nothing stopping us from our maritime vision of creating a maritime industry. But even that we haven't shown, even after 70 years, after the example of South Korea, the
Asian Tiger, China, etc. So there is a certainly a total absence of strategic vision in our polity. I mean, they are so busy with electioneering from one election to the next that no minister has the time or mental space to devote to his portfolio. He leaves it to the bureaucracy. The bureaucracy is just not important. That's my
I am Prakash, teacher at Goa University. Very informative lecture. I had pleasure to listen to Admiral Sir's lecture 2-3 years before in the same more or less same scenario you mentioned that time. So it is very clear from your lecture that we are good enough only for go to visit by Navy. And we can't be disruptor with the kind of attitude we have, strategic attitude which Admiral Mehta said that PHE has very type of attitude everywhere in bureaucracy.
That's national.
Yeah, right. But it matters there, no? Bureaucracy, defense, political, you know that. And so we can't be disruptive. And also our equipment are so poor. Most of them are purchased from decommissioned and during part time we have to hide them because we don't have peripheral for them. Under this scenario, my question is, and another point is that China is now making ports or having collaboration with Bangladesh, Colombo, and with Pakistan. Under this scenario, I would have liked to know about the disadvantage and advantage of ORF. Why India is not going into it, or whether India should go into it?
ORF? ROP?
That one road, one
road.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to now start clubbing questions otherwise. So I request our two actors to kindly please so just take them. So next.
It's not a question but a small observation. I'm a forester basically, but work mostly in Andamans and coastal development, department and Antarctica. You also mentioned Antarctica. I was actually waiting, but that's one access which you are missing totally. It gives us the longest opportunity for Navy to operate or help us in operation. You know, when I was in ocean development between 2002 to 2007, it was great difficulty I could convince MOD and they withdrew from the Antarctic program, the support, logistics. And the reason was that it's a civilian operation and our people will be there to be inducted into the military operation, which was pretty surprising for me. And MO6 they refused to talk to us on that issue, and now we are hiring the retired people just to run our operation. And we have constructed a second base, the Bharti, which is just down below India, 75 degree east longitude. I think there's a big opportunity for Navy to come forward, and the size, the deployment, you said mentioned that Indian Ocean, that seabed region, 75,000 square meters with us, and 75,000 with our cross. And we have also constructed a ship, which is ice class. I don't think Navy has an ice class ship also, because these are things costly, but we could spend about 1,000 crore and fit difficulty. Okay. We have to be persuasive. The bureaucracy, it was difficult for me to, on the other side, to convince the defense to come together and work on these strategic and long-term things, because the new station where we have constructed now with great difficulty, I actually literally fought in our Antarctic Treaty meeting to get the clearances for setting that station, because except the second base is on the sea side, the Bharti station.
My question is to Admiral Arun Prakash. You mentioned in your talk about the hegemony of China in South China Sea. And if I understood correctly, USA, Australia, Japan and India can align to kind of create some kind of a deterrent for China to prevent them from, and to keep them at bay. Now, we are also planning, India is also planning some economic activities there, if I'm not mistaken, oil exploration and other things. So in that particular case, do you think all these three countries will come to our rescue in case China tries to be belligerent?
About Antarctica, I find it inconceivable that the Navy would have backed out or hesitated to support this, because I think we're about first 7 or 8 expeditions, the Navy sent helicopters, crew, actually met officers, etc. So I find it quite inconceivable that the Navy would back out because there's no reason for it. Naval officers are always willing to go. It's a great experience for them. What possibly has happened is that the MOD bureaucracy decided that this was not a good idea, and you must draw a line, because the MOD and the service headquarters are two separate entities which don't see eye to eye most of the time. That I had referred to it in my talk also. It's unique worldwide that a major military power should have a situation in which the Ministry of Defense and the services do not see eye to eye. So that is possibly the reason for the complaint that you are making. If somehow you can go back to the Navy, probably come. Captain, the this question is that you know, we are not in a position to confront China militarily or, you know, in the maritime region. We are not. They are far superior to us. And I think my friend Sureesh Mehta had made this publicly. He had announced it a few years ago that we got left behind long ago. And every day we are slipping even further behind China. So we cannot confront them face to face. So it is in our interest to avoid a confrontation. How do you avoid confrontation in international relations is to, there are various ways you form alliances, you do power balancing, etc. So this quad business is only, it's like shadow boxing, that you say, okay, if you do something to me, then maybe USA will come to my help, or Australia, nobody will actually come to your help, because everybody seeks their own self-interest, and China is far too important economically for anyone to take bungas with China. So, all the shadow boxing, insurance, etc., we can do and hope for the best. But it is in our interest for the next 15, 20, 30 years to ensure there is no conflict and avoid close quarter situations, etc. And one of the ways is to deepen economic ties with China, diplomatic relations. After all, I'm sure they also don't want a conflict. It's not in their interest. And trade will help them. Their economy is also slowly slowing down and heading for trouble. So, and India is a big market. So, it is in mutual interest for us to maintain good relations with China. But of course, self-respect and national prestige, etc., those are things. If they push you too hard, then where do we go? So, we must have some contingency. So, this quad, etc., is for those purposes that, you know, you've got to have some.
Yes, it is true that, but I think in both these questions, the previous side also, what you mentioned and here, I just want to make one point. What is lacking more than anything else is vision and total incontinuity in the jobs that people are doing. How can you have a defense secretary whose last job was minister in the highways and
Highway, road transport,
service transport. This is exactly the case. Never been in the defense ministry, and then suddenly lands up over there. So comprehension is very poor. Biases are totally different, and many of the people, both politicians as well as bureaucrats, come out with this kind of a thing. Any military go mando. Without any thought process. So that is another thing which is lacking quite a lot and later. But again, as I said, you know, if you have a slave or a corpuscle, then it becomes very difficult.
This entire concept of Indo-Pacific or Indo-Asia Pacific, I mean, basically it's a US articulation. Should we treat this with a little bit of caution? Because are we being drawn into an area where we could better not venture? I mean, the Pacific is a pretty messed up area right now. You've got island disputes, sovereignty disputes, water disputes, and we've got enough later over here in the Indian Ocean. So should we just stick to the Indian Ocean without being drawn into the Pacific?
I think first of all, many fathers to the Indo-Pacific idea. I mean, the United States clearly, Pacific Command and Hawaii and all these guys, and some of the people who produced it. But you know, that was an idea somewhat lurking in our extended neighborhood notion. You know, the moment we said that, Southeast Asian and Central Asian dynamics were as important to us as South Asian dynamics, or from a maritime perspective, that our perimeter of defense extended from this, minimally from the states, Straits of Malacca to the Straits of Hormuz. When we start, you know, articulating our external protection in those ways, and these are, by the way, not academic articulations, these are, as you know, policy articulations, then, you know, there is a certain logic about it, it expanding, you know, I mean, it becomes very difficult to see the Indian Ocean alone as that container. The problem is that, you know, because the Indian Ocean itself has, is this transit ocean, you know, for both the Pacific and the Atlantic. Pretty maxed out. It's rarely that you see an audience more exhausted than the speaker. This seems to be the case today. But it's not, I assure you, I assure our distinguished speakers about, because of the presentations, both of which were frankly quite outstanding. And then I do hope Dr. Pradhan gets his act together with this promised volume.
Yes.
All of us who made a presentation supposedly are supposed to be writing a chapter for this volume. So, you know, I hope that happens as well. Thank again once more Admiral Arun Prakash and Admiral Sureesh Mehta for having spared so much time and spent the time with us. It's very rare to have two service chiefs together on a panel, and it's very gracious of them both to have accepted to be co-panelists, and I think we are very grateful to them for that. With that, any last announcements, or should I declare the Thank you very much. Good evening.